चलो नाउ मूविंग ऑन टूवर्ड्स द थर्ड पाथवे विच आई हैड इन्फॉर्म्ड यू ऑल बिफोर दैट इज कैंप पाथवे. वी हैव कवर्ड C3 C4 साइकिल एंड नाउ वी आर गोइंग टू टॉक अबाउट अ डिफरेंट काइंड ऑफ मेटाबॉलिज्म कॉल्ड कैम विच एक्चुअली स्टैंड्स फॉर crassulation acid metabolism. Now, what is this metabolism? Which are the plants that are going to exhibit it? And why are they showing a different kind of pathway? So firstly, your first question, your first doubt should be, ma'am, what is going to happen in this particular pathway? Again, we are going to fix CO2 and form glucose because we are still talking about dark reaction. And dark reaction is all about fixing carbon dioxide and converting it into glucose. So over here, like we had a C3 plant showing a different pathway, C4 plant showing a different pathway, here we have a CAM plant which exhibits a different kind of pathway. Alright, now which are the plants that are going to exhibit it? The plants which belong to family, some members of family, one second. Some members of U4BAC. Some plants belonging to Crassulaceae. Okay, there would be certain cacti which are going to show it. Now, when I have used the term cacti, it should immediately strike. Okay, ma'am is talking probably about xerophytic plants. So, this is a kind of adaptation exhibited by those plants which are in a completely dry habitat. Yeah, so plants which are in dry habitat, they are the ones which are going to show this kind of adaptation and this kind of pathway for production of glucose. Alright, now the thing is, you know that for adaptation, for when it comes to adaptation guys, different kind of plants exhibit different type of adaptation to adjust to the environment, to the surrounding. Over here also, when the conditions are very dry, the temperature is soaring high, the availability of water is quite less, the kind of adaptation exhibited by these plants is they are going to change the timings of opening and closing of stomata. The adaptation is during daytime, the stoma is closed, and during nighttime, the stoma is open. Now you know why. During night time, the temperature is a bit lower. So at that point of time, the rate of transpiration is not that high. And automatically, the transpiration rate goes low and plant can afford to open the stoma during night. This kind of stomata is specifically, or this kind of activity of stomata is said to be scoto-active stomata. Children, in plant growth and development, we have already come across the term scoto. Photoperiodism was in relation to your light period, and scoto was with respect to your dark. Right, children? Over here, scoto-active stomata, matlab a stomata which is active during night time. Okay? Now, what about the process of photosynthesis? It's exactly same as C4 only. In C4, we had an upper compartment of MSC and a lower compartment of BSC. Over here, we don't have such compartments. We just have mesophyll wherein the whole fixation is going to occur. In C4, we had pepcase functioning, rubisco functioning. Over here, also we have pepcase and rubisco, which are going to function together. Okay, I'll talk about that in detail. But before that, I want to give further examples of the same. Yeah, please learn these examples, children. That's something called sedum, calanco, I had mentioned about Opuntia earlier. There's something called agave. Yeah, all of them are going to show camp pathway. Okay, so children, now let's talk about what exactly is happening in camp pathway. As I have already mentioned, we have two conditions: stomata being open during night time and stomata being closed during daytime. And this all adaptation is seen so that water can be conserved, rate of transpiration can be reduced. Okay guys, so let's start with the pathway. So I have drawn two compartments over here. The left one is the condition that is at night time. So what happens during night time and what happens during daytime? Okay, so let's start. Children, again I have just now spoken that the difference between C4 and CAM pathway, one of the differences, C4 pathway is conducted in two different compartments, that's your MSC and BSC, but CAM pathway entirely would be conducted only and only in mesophyll region. So whatever cells you are seeing right now is mesophyll only. Okay, so this is your mesophyll region, the upper epidermis. Yeah, this shows that the stomata is open right now as it is a night time. Due to the open stomata, you have gaseous exchange going on. Due to gaseous exchange, children, your carbon dioxide can easily come in and a bit of transpiration would be seen wherein water is going to move out. As we had spoken, even during your C4 pathway, this carbon dioxide would be converted into carbonic acid and that carbonic acid would be dissociated to form something called HCO3-. Children, this HCO3- would be now trapped by somebody called phosphoenol pyruvic acid. That's your PEPA. Yeah, your PEPA is a 3-carbon compound. This one has 1 carbon and it is going to form a 4-carbon compound. That is again oxaloacetic acid. It's a 4-carbon compound. And children, as we are already aware, the enzyme catalyzing this reaction is PEPCase, phosphoenol pyruvic carboxylase. Now guys, this oxaloacetic acid which has been formed is going to undergo the same reduction wala step. So if you want, I'll note down the steps also over here. This is your carboxylation. This is the next step, that is reduction. And during reduction, what is happening, children? You have the hydrogen donor NADPH. So here comes your NADPH, which gets converted to NADP plus and forms something called malic acid. Malic acid is again a 4-carbon compound. Now children, all these things, again I'm mentioning, is happening inside the cells of mesophyll region. Now this malic acid, during night time, it is the one which is going to get accumulated in the vacuole. So this malic acid would be accumulated in vacuole. So you will have 1 CO2, 2nd CO2, 3rd CO2, 4th CO2, number of CO2s coming in. At night, only this much is going to happen. Entry of CO2, conversion into malic acid. So constantly children, you may find that at night, the pH decreases or acidification happens. Okay? So please remember, again it's an important neat question. So during night time, children, loads and loads of CO2 are going to come in and they will be converted to oxaloacetic acid. Oxaloacetic acid would get reduced, convert into malic acid, and this malic acid would be stored in the vacuole. Alright, that's it. Only this much is happening at night. Now let's talk about what's happening during the daytime. Now children, during daytime, where is your malic acid present? Your malic acid is present inside something called vacuole. So here's a vacuole which has lots and lots of malic acid, which is a 4-carbon compound. This is going to come out. Okay, now when this malic acid comes out, it's here again I'm writing malic acid. This malic acid is going to convert into something called pyruvic acid. Children, malic acid is 4-carbon. We know that pyruvic acid is with how many carbons? 3 carbons. Matlab, what has come out, children? What has been released? There has been a release of something called CO2. And guys, this carbon dioxide will be captured into a cycle that's called Kelvin cycle. And it is the one which is going to form glucose, which would be converted and stored in the form of starch. Now, there's one more thing which I need to point out over here. It's not given in NCERT. Children, CAM pathway in detail has not been mentioned in NCERT. This is only for your information by chance if they ask us. So, one more thing what's happening over here is, when malic acid is converting into pyruvic acid, there's one more change. The change is your NADP plus forms NADPH. Please remember this. Now, who is the acceptor of carbon dioxide over here in CAM pathway? It's again PEPA. That means we need to regenerate PEPA. And for the regeneration part of PEPA, children, this pyruvic acid is going to undergo the step that is called phosphorylation. And during the phosphorylation, as I had spoken during the C4 pathway, guys, you have ATP being used up, which forms AMP. The same set of enzyme is going to function over here, and this forms your phosphoenol pyruvic acid, ready for the next accepting. Okay? Acha, one more thing. Over here, children, stomata is closed. As this is the daytime, I am mentioning over here, stomata or stoma is closed. And again, over here I am writing stoma is open. Okay guys? So, once again, let's do this. CAM pathway is an exclusive phenomena of certain plants which are adapted to stay in dry habitat. The adaptation includes a scotoactive stomata, not to forget sunken stomata also. We have studied this in our initial chapters, that a xerophytic adaptation would show sunken stomata. So two things, the stomata is active during night, so I call it scotoactive. It is also a sunken kind of stomata. So let's come back, children. We have mesophyll cells only, which is going to show the whole pathway. There is nothing like bundle sheath like we saw in your C4 pathway. What's happening over here is, guys, during night time when the stomata is open, there is exchange of gas seen. Water and CO2 is getting exchanged. CO2 enters inside the cell, the mesophyll cell. It forms carbonic acid, which is dissociated, forming bicarbonate ion, which is trapped by the primary acceptor, that's called PEPA. That's a 3-carbon compound. The enzyme catalyzing this reaction called carboxylation is PEPCase, that is phosphoenol pyruvic carboxylase, and it forms oxaloacetic acid. It's a 4-carbon compound. This oxaloacetic acid undergoes reduction. The donor is NADPH, which gets converted to NADP+, and malic acid is formed. Now guys, this malic acid is going to continuously form during the night time, and they are going to get accumulated in the vacuole. There would be loads and loads of CO2 entering in, because ugly subha, the next day, दे अगेन हैव टू क्लोज टोमाटा. सो जितना हो सकता है दे आर गोइंग टू कीप ऑन अक्यूमुलेटिंग कार्बन डाइऑक्साइड. सो एट नाइट द पीएच ड्रॉप्स. देर इज समथिंग कॉल्ड एसिडिफिकेशन सीन बिकॉज लॉट्स एंड लॉट्स ऑफ मैलिक एसिड इज गेटिंग अक्यूमुलेटेड. During daytime, what happens is the stoma is closed. When the stoma is closed and your vacuole has lots and lots of malic acid, that malic acid is going to convert into pyruvic acid by a step called decarboxylation. Decarboxylation, that is release of CO2. Also, you find over here NADP plus getting converted to NADPH, which leads to formation of pyruvic acid. The carbon which is released while this conversion happens is trapped by C3 cycle, the secondary acceptor of carbon dioxide over there, that's RuBP, and the enzyme catalyzing is same, that is Rubisco, which leads to formation of glucose. The pyruvic acid is then phosphorylated, wherein ATP converts into AMP and PEPA is regenerated. Now this PEPA is further ready for the night time, wherein new CO2 molecules are going to enter inside. Okay, chums, the last part of dark reaction, that is photorespiration. This photorespiration is also termed as PCO cycle, that stands for photosynthetic carbon oxidation. It's also termed to be C2 cycle, or we call it glycolate metabolism. Now children, this photorespiration was discovered by somebody called, Dicker and Teo. They had identified in a plant called Tobacco. And guys, this Tobacco is a C3 variety. It's a C3 plant. Okay? Now what happens in your photorespiration? What exactly it is? Guys, this photorespiration is a light dependent process of oxygenation of RuBP. So basically what's happening over here is, in photorespiration you will find it that your RuBP is getting oxygenated. So it is oxygenation of RuBP, and due to this oxidation what happens is there is a release of carbon dioxide. Okay, so normally photosynthetic organs do the reverse in light, that is uptake of CO2 and release of oxygen, but over here in photorespiration it's happening reverse, it is uptake of oxygen and release of CO2. Yeah, it's not like normal process what we see, and thus it is quite difficult to identify, or we can say to demonstrate, this particular reaction. Yes, so how do we identify that aisa kuch ho raha hai plant mein? If in case we find that there is a decrease in the rate of net photosynthesis, then we can say photorespiration must have occurred. Or if there is a sudden increased evolution of CO2, then we can say that photorespiration has occurred. Okay, now what is the site of this particular reaction? Children, site of your photorespiration, it includes, of course, everything is going to happen in your chloroplast, right? We are talking about photosynthesis, so chloroplast has to be involved. Other than chloroplast, you also have something called peroxisome, which is involved in this particular reaction, and mitochondria. So the site of photorespiration is chloroplast, peroxisome, and mitochondria. All three organelles are responsible, are involved in the complete process of photorespiration. And guys, it's a cyclic process. That's why I've mentioned over here C2 cycle. I've just mentioned C2, but it is C2 cycle. Okay? Now the thing is, the enzyme RUBP. RUBP's full form goes like what? It is ribulose biscarboxylase oxygenase. Now this RUBP has an active site, which is for both carboxylation also and for oxygenation. So please remember that Rubisco, the enzyme, I have already mentioned the full form earlier. Okay, still I'll write the full form once again. It is ribulose biscarboxylase oxygenase. So we can say that your Rubisco has active site for both. It has active site for CO2 also, and it has an active site for oxygen also. That means if CO2 is available, it is going to fix up CO2, and if oxygen is available, it is going to fix oxygen also. This leads to the oxygenation of RUBP, as I mentioned before. So if Rubisco is taking in oxygen, that means definitely you will have oxygenation of RUBP. Or else if carbon dioxide is coming in, it would be the carboxylation process. Right, children? So as I mentioned, I'm just quickly revising it. Your photorespiration is photosynthetic carbon oxidation cycle, or the C2 cycle, or also called glycolate metabolism. It was for the first time identified in Tobacco, which is a C3 variety. So with this, we clearly understand that it is not the C4 plants which is going to show, it is the C3 plants which is going to show, or which is showing photorespiration. Please remember this. I'll note it out for your seen in C3 plants. Please remember, it's a very important point. Okay, the site is chloroplast, peroxisome, mitochondria. All three are involved in the process of photorespiration. Rubisco, whose full form is ribulose biscarboxylase oxygenase, has active site for both carbon dioxide also and for oxygen also. Okay. Of course, the enzyme has more affinity for CO2. The affinity is more towards carbon dioxide than oxygen. Now children, if we have a look at this particular Rubisco's activity in a schematic representation, it would be somewhat like this. I have this enzyme called Rubisco here. It is showing dual activity. What kind of activity? Wherein the first one, wherein it is the one which is going to trap carbon dioxide, right? Under normal conditions, it is trapping carbon dioxide, and you have something called photosynthesis being conducted, wherein I can say it is showing an activity that is called its carboxylase activity. Okay, and this exclusively will occur when the conditions are absolutely normal, under normal conditions. But on the other hand, if there is some abnormal conditions, what kind of abnormal condition? If the temperature is high, or the oxygen concentration is high, under these two conditions, instead of trapping carbon dioxide, your Rubisco is going to trap something called oxygen. So here comes oxygen, and this kind of activity is exhibited by its second nature, that is oxygenase. When the first thing happens, that is, it is trapping carbon dioxide, your Rubisco is trapping carbon dioxide, and the Rubisco enzyme is showing its carboxylase activity, the entire process would be termed to be photosynthesis. It is exhibiting photosynthesis. Yeah, but on the other hand, if it is trapping oxygen when the temperature is high, or when the oxygen concentration is high, it is going to show a phenomena. That phenomena is called photo respiration. Okay. Now, the thing is, this process, that is your photorespiration, would bring about loss of 25% of the fixed carbon. I'm noting it over here. It is going to decrease the efficiency of photosynthesis, and it will bring about 25% loss in carbon. Okay, so I can say that the entire process of photorespiration is basically a wasteful process. Now children, when you sit and solve the MCQs, you may come across a term called Warburg effect. What is this Warburg effect? Firstly, we have just now read about photorespiration. Photorespiration is decrease in the rate of photosynthesis, which is due to high oxygen concentration. Right? This itself is Warburg effect. The Warburg effect is the decrease in the, I'll just note it, Warburg's effect is the decrease in rate of photosynthesis by high oxygen concentration So over here what happens is, your oxygen acts as a competitive inhibitor for CO2. Both of them are going to compete for the same enzyme, for the same enzyme's active site, that is Rubisco. So oxygen is acting as a competitive inhibitor. Against carbon dioxide, and both of them are competing for Rubisco. So I can say that your oxygen promotes photorespiration, which reduces the photosynthetic output. Right? It promotes photorespiration, and decreases rate of photosynthesis. So guys, this is your Warburg effect. So children, now let's proceed towards the schematic representation of your photorespiration pathway. As I had mentioned before, there are three different organelles involved in your photorespiration or the C2 or the glycolate metabolism pathway. The first one, that's your chloroplast. The second one comes up as peroxisome. And the third one, that's your mitochondria. So, the first one here is chloroplast. The second is peroxisome. And the third one, that's your mitochondria. Let's start. So guys, photorespiration is because of a kind of activity, a dual kind of activity exhibited by Rubisco. Rubisco is present in chloroplast. So the first kind of activity would be exhibited by chloroplast only. So children, you have RUBP present in your chloroplast, ribulose biphosphate. This ribulose biphosphate is going to trap, instead of CO2, it is going to trap something called oxygen. Just a moment. it traps oxygen, and this is because of the activity of your enzyme, that's Rubisco here. Now, the moment RuBP traps oxygen, the 5-carbon compound, that is your RuBP, is going to ultimately, as there is no addition of carbon, ultimately on the right hand side, you will have 5-carbon compound only, but split it into two different molecules. Firstly, you have your 3-carbon PGA formed over here, and along with that, this is your 3-carbon compound, along with that, you will have something called phosphoglycolate. This phosphoglycolate is a 2-carbon compound. I have mentioned it over here. It is a 2-carbon compound. Now, this phosphoglycolate is going to get dephosphorylated. When it gets dephosphorylated, guys, phosphate is going to come out and it will be taken care by, you may directly write IP also, but some of the reference books mention it as H3PO4. So phosphate is given out and phosphoric acid has been formed, and you have the compound formed over here as glycolate. This glycolate is again a 2-carbon compound. Okay. Now guys, this glycolate from chloroplast is going to travel to the next organelle. The next organelle, that is peroxisomes. So glycolate has traveled to peroxisome, and over here, children, one second, glycolate, which is a 2-carbon compound, has reached your peroxisome, wherein it is going to undergo oxidation, and this oxidation would lead to production of something called glyoxylate. Your glycolate undergoes oxidation and it forms glyoxylate. Okay. So over here, children, oxygen is used up and you will have release of H2O2, that is hydrogen peroxide. Okay. Now this glyoxylate is going to undergo a transamination reaction. In a previous chapter, we have understood what is reductive amination and transamination. So this glyoxylate, which is again a 2-carbon compound, is going to undergo a transamination reaction, which would ultimately lead to formation of glycine. This glycine is also a 2-carbon compound. Now, what kind of reaction happens over here, children? This is again extremely important. You have glyoxylate with you all. Now, this glyoxylate is going to release the amino group. It's going to be captured by something called glutamate, which would be converting it into alpha keto glutaric acid. This is a transamination reaction which happens, and it leads to production of glycine. Now this glycine is going to travel to your last organelle, that is mitochondria. The glycine with 2-carbon has reached mitochondria now. The glycine which has reached your mitochondria is going to undergo a step called decarboxylation, as mitochondria has an enzyme called decarboxylase present over here. But glycine just has 2 carbons. If it loses 1 carbon, it will be left with only 1 carbon. So what happens next in this particular process is one more entry of an oxygen molecule. So there would be one more oxygen entering inside, children. It would be fixed using the enzyme Rubisco, RUBP is going to undergo oxygenation, and there would be one more molecule of PGA formed. Please have a look at the chloroplast section, children, now. So there would be one more molecule of PGA as well as one more molecule of phosphoglycolate. This phosphoglycolate is going to, the second phosphoglycolate is going to undergo again dephosphorylation, forming glycolate. Glycolate will now again travel, the second glycolate will again travel towards your peroxisome. The second glycolate is going to undergo oxidation, forming glyoxylate for the second time now. Your glyoxylate is going to undergo transamination reaction, forming your glycine. So right now I have the second molecule of glycine, and the second molecule of glycine is traveling towards your mitochondria. So in all, right now I have two molecules of glycine, guys, which accounts to totally four carbons. Now what's going to happen is this particular glycine is going to release carbon, and as soon as it releases carbon, it is going to form a three carbon compound. So I'm showing an exit of CO2 over here. So CO2 moves out, decarboxylation has occurred, children, right? And it forms another compound, a three carbon compound, that is called serine. That's another amino acid. Now while this particular reaction is happening, guys, what happens is you have formation of NADH also. So you have two molecules of glycine. Those two molecules of glycine totally accounts for four carbon, right? Out of those, one carbon is lost in the form of carbon dioxide, that is decarboxylation has occurred, and simultaneously you also have production of your NAD plus converting into NADH. Alright, one more thing is happening over here, guys. Your glycine, we had two molecules of glycine, that means each of them is going to show NH3 group. That particular NH3 group is also released out, right? You had two molecules of NH3, one would be released and one would be still attached with the three carbons, forming your serine molecule. Okay, so now what happens is this serine, which was formed in your mitochondria, is going to travel to peroxisome. I had told you it's a cycle. So serine is traveling towards peroxisome, and guys, this serine over here is now going to show again a transamination reaction. So here's the serine. The serine is going to show the transamination reaction, wherein your alpha ketoglutaric acid is going to form your glutamate. And for this, not to forget, your NH3, which was released over here in your mitochondria, would be used up. Okay? And this serine converts into something called hydroxypyruvate. This hydroxypyruvate is now going to undergo the next step, wherein it is going to use up the H of NADH and convert it into something called NAD+, which leads to production of the glycerate molecule. Guys, please note, your serine is a three carbon compound, hydroxypyruvate is a three carbon compound, your glycerate is also a three carbon compound. Now this glycerate travels back to your chloroplast. It's traveling towards chloroplast. Yeah? And it's going to get phosphorylated. Now when I'm saying it's going to undergo phosphorylation, what I mean to say is there would be a use of ATP converting into ADP, and it would lead to formation of PGA. Okay, which is going to now continue the cycle. So guys, this is the entire process of photorespiration. I'll quickly have a recap of it. RUBP and Rubisco. RUBP is the acceptor of oxygen also and carbon dioxide also, as Rubisco, the enzyme which is going to catalyze this particular reaction, is showing dual activity of carboxylase and oxygenase. Now this Rubisco, when traps oxygen, it's going to form two compounds. One of those is PGA and the second one formed is phosphoglycolate. Now whatever metabolism we are going to talk about would be with respect to phosphoglycolate only. Your phosphoglycolate is going to undergo dephosphorylation. By addition of water, it's going to form phosphoric acid, which will then convert into glycolate. Now glycolate travels to peroxisome, and over there it is going to undergo oxidation, which would lead to formation of hydrogen peroxide, and eventually it's going to form glyoxylate. This glyoxylate is going to now undergo a transamination reaction forming glycine. Glycine travels to mitochondria, meets an enzyme decarboxylase, releases a carbon dioxide, is left with one carbon and cannot proceed with it, and hence there would be a second molecule of oxygen entering in. Now this oxygen would repeat the entire process right from phosphoglycolate till again the formation of glycine. So totally we have two phosphoglycolates, two glycolate, two glyoxylate and two glycines. Eventually I am left with four carbon, out of which one carbon is lost in the form of carbon dioxide, and I am left with three carbon compound. That's called serine, formed after your NAD plus undergoing oxidation and forming reduction and forming NADH, and glycine oxidizes to serine along with deamination reaction, wherein your glycine, just because we had two molecules of glycine, we also had two molecules of NH3, one of the NH3 is released out, which is sent to peroxisome. Now serine also travels to peroxisome, wherein it undergoes a transamination reaction, eventually forming hydroxypyruvate. Hydroxypyruvate is the one which is then going to form glycerate by addition of hydrogen. And glycerate travels to chloroplast. It undergoes a phosphorylation reaction by the donor ATP and converts into phosphoglyceric acid. I hope the schematic representation is clear, children. Yes? We saw a detailed schematic representation of photorespiration pathway, also called C2 pathway. But the thing which I could not mention in that particular pathway was about the enzymes. So over here, I'm mentioning step-by-step reaction along with the enzyme's name. In case you have any kind of confusion, please have a look at the detailed reactions. So the first reaction, was wherein oxygenation of RUBP was seen. So RUBP along with oxygen, in presence of the enzyme Rubisco, which showed a dual nature, and the oxygenase activity was seen over here, it led to production of phosphoglyceric acid along with phosphoglycolate. Now the second set of reaction, children, this phosphoglycolate combined with water in presence of the enzyme phosphatase, which led to release of phosphate group from it, and it produced glycolate, and there was a release of phosphoric acid. In the third set of reaction, this glycolate which was formed is getting oxidized. So we have glycolate. It is the one which is going to be acted upon by oxidase, forming glyoxylate along with release of hydrogen peroxide. And the fourth set of reaction, there was something called transamination reaction, wherein your glyoxylate along with glutamate in presence of enzyme transaminase is going to form glycine and alpha keto glutarate. Now, as mentioned, glycine is with only two carbons. It's going to wait for another fixation of oxygen, and you will have two molecules of glycine, which is going to combine with NAD+, and it is the one which is going to undergo decarboxylation in presence of enzyme decarboxylase. While this decarboxylation occurs, you have one molecule of serine getting produced along with the release of carbon dioxide, which happens in mitochondria, along with release of an NH3 group plus NADH. Nextly, the serine which is formed in your mitochondria is going to undergo the similar transamination reaction in presence of enzyme transaminase, it's going to form hydroxypyruvate along with glutamate. Now, this hydroxypyruvate is going to accept hydrogen coming from NADH in presence of an enzyme called reductase, forming glycerate, and there would be release of NAD+. This glycerate is now going to get phosphorylated by the phosphate donor, that is ATP, in presence of an enzyme that's kinase, forming phosphoglycerate along with release of ADP. So these are the detailed reactions along with the enzyme's name, children. Children, now let's talk about the factors affecting reactive photosynthesis. Now we have classified the factors into two different types. There's something called plant factors and the other one that is external factors. I'm first talking about the plant factors. The first very important factor, the internal one, is, see, we know that leaf is the one which is responsible for major conduction of photosynthesis. So of course we'll first have a look at all possible leaf related factors. The first one, that is number of leaves. It's quite logical that number of leaves would be directly proportional to the rate of photosynthesis, right? So more the number of leaves, more would be the rate of photosynthesis, right? The second factor related to leaf could be size of leaves. Again, it would be directly proportional to the rate of photosynthesis, right? Thirdly, we can talk about the orientation of leaves. Orientation of leaf in such a way that it favors, you know, maximum or optimum light absorption. So the third factor could be orientation. of leaves. It should be in such a way that favors optimum light absorption. Okay. Next could be age of leaf. Now, as a leaf is developing, the rate of photosynthesis rises with the age till it becomes maximum at its full maturity. But later on, the rate of photosynthesis is going to decline. So as aging occurs, the rate of photosynthesis decreases, you know, because enzymes activity also decreases and even the chlorophyll regeneration stops. So degeneration of chlorophyll happens. So I can say over here, rate increases with age, but up to a limit. Later, as leaf starts aging, rate decreases. Okay. So I've spoken about number of leaves, I've spoken about size of leaves, orientation of leaves. Nextly, I can talk about number of chloroplasts. So, number of chloroplasts I can directly say is directly proportional to the rate of photosynthesis. More the number of chloroplasts, more would be the rate of photosynthesis, right? Nextly, it could be amount of chlorophyll present. Guys, amount of chlorophyll will also be directly proportional to the rate of photosynthesis. More the number of chlorophyll, more would be the rate. Okay. Nextly, I can say that hormones. Achha, hormones would come under the entire plant. Okay, I'm specifically talking about leaf. So let me put a last point of leaf anatomy. Leaf anatomy also influences the rate of diffusion, right? Like stromatal opening, the mesophyll cells, they're going to immediately trap CO2. So a proper anatomy of leaf also influences the rate of photosynthesis. Also, not to forget the Krahn's anatomy being more efficient, like C4 plants are more efficient. So leaf anatomy matters. When we talk about C3 plant, they are less efficient, but C4 plant has various kind of adaptations, and that's how the structure entirely is, and it is going to eventually matter a lot. Nextly, I can talk about hormones. There are some hormones which are going to increase the rate of photosynthesis. For example, you have cytokinins and gibberellic acid. Both of them are going to increase the rate of photosynthesis. Okay, but if I talk about ABA, that is abscisic acid, it is known to decrease the rate of photosynthesis. These are going to increase. Okay, nextly, accumulation of end products. What is the end product of photosynthesis? Glucose. Now, supposedly there is slow rate of translocation, which causes the accumulation of photosynthetic end products. This would decrease the rate of photosynthesis because the plant will not find any requirement of increasing the rate of photosynthesis. So I can say slow rate of translocation that causes accumulation of end product, will reduce the rate of photosynthesis. Children, this is a very important question also. Okay. So these are all the plant factors responsible or affecting the rate of photosynthesis. So guys, moving on towards the external factors that affect the rate of photosynthesis. Now there are various factors like sunlight, temperature, CO2 concentration, water, which contribute to be the external factor affecting the rate of photosynthesis. But before we move on towards those factors, let us understand one very important law that's called law of limiting factor. This law of limiting factor was given by Blackman. Now what does this law say? You know, it's like if you have a chemical process going on and there are multiple factors that affect the rate, like as I mentioned just now, photosynthesis is affected by sunlight, temperature, CO2, water. So there are multiple factors which are affecting this particular photosynthesis. So if such a process is going on which is affected by more than one factor, then the rate of that particular process would be determined by the factor which is at the minimum value or at a suboptimal level. The others which are optimum, that will not change the rate. But the one which is lowest or the minimum or below optimum levels, that will rule the rate of photosynthesis. This is what the law of limiting factor says. In writing now, children, if a chemical process is affected by more than one factor, then its rate will be determined by the factor that is at minimum or suboptimal level. Okay, so this is law of limiting factor, which was given by Blackman. Now children, let's move on towards the external factors that affect the rate of photosynthesis. The first one which I want to discuss is about carbon dioxide. Carbon dioxide concentration. Guys, this carbon dioxide concentration is a major limiting factor for photosynthesis. There are certain values which you need to remember, which are given in NCERT. The first thing that the carbon dioxide concentration is quite low in the atmosphere. It ranges between 0.03 and 0.04, 1 second, percent. Yeah, so this is the values of CO2 in atmosphere. It has been observed that increase in concentration of up to 0.05% will cause an increase in CO2 fixation rates. Yeah, so increase in concentration up to 0.05% increases the rate of CO2 fixation, that is, increases the rate of photosynthesis. Now the thing is, we have two major varieties of plants, that is C3 and C4. Both the plants are going to respond in a different way to the varying carbon dioxide concentration. If I talk about low light intensities, at low light intensity, none of these plants are going to respond to the high CO2 levels. Of course, when the light is low, what will it do with CO2? If there is no ATP and NADPH production. So at low light intensity, carbon dioxide concentration or a high carbon dioxide concentration really doesn't matter. But at high light intensity, both C3 and C4 plants show increase in the rate of photosynthesis with increase in CO2 levels. Yeah, a very important point to note, children. Your C4 plant shows saturation at about 360 ppm . On the other hand, your C3 plant is going to show saturation at around 450 ppm . Now guys, again I'm telling you, these figures are really very important. Make sure you learn them. Okay, there's one more thing which I want to talk about when I'm talking about carbon dioxide concentration, that is carbon dioxide compensation point, CO2 compensation point. Now what is this carbon dioxide compensation point? So children, we have always observed that there is a decline beyond 0.1% when carbon dioxide concentration is reduced. There comes a point, you know, at which the plant stop absorbing CO2 from the environment, and this is called the compensation point, which has been also termed as threshold value. Now what does this mean? At this value, your fixed carbon dioxide, that is via photosynthesis, and the evolved carbon dioxide equalizes. When is carbon dioxide evolved? Two processes, you know, when CO2 is evolved. One is respiration, and the second one, that is photorespiration, right? So what is carbon dioxide concentration compensation point or the threshold value? It's basically at this value, that is your threshold value, CO2 fixed during photosynthesis is equal to CO2 evolved during respiration and photorespiration. Okay, now even this value varies for your C3 and C4 plant. Carbon dioxide compensation point I'm talking about. The value for your C3 plant is 25 to 100 ppm, and for your C4 plant it is 0 to 10 ppm. Now over here again you see that the compensation point is lower for C4. 0 to 10 ppm, it is lower for C4, and this lowered value is because of the efficient activity of PEPCase. Efficient activity wherein it tries and fixes almost all the CO2 which is available. But on the other hand, your Rubisco based fixation mein, you have, you know, the efficiency being decreased. Okay, So guys, please remember the figures, the values over here. I hope you have understood what is compensation point and how is your carbon dioxide kind of factor responsible for affecting the rate of photosynthesis. The next factor, the next external factor, that is light intensity. So guys, light intensity is going to vary with different latitude, altitude, season, topography, yeah? And we can classify plants basically into two different types. On their ability, whether they can, you know, tolerate high intensity of light or they cannot tolerate. So we have two different varieties of plants. They are called sclerophytes. Or the second one is heliophytes. Now guys, the sclerophytes are the ones which cannot tolerate high light intensity, and that is the reason why we also call them shade plants or shade loving plants. Heliophytes are the ones which can bear high light intensity, and that is why they are called sun loving plants or sun plants. Okay, now it is quite logical that at low light intensity, the rate of photosynthesis is going to definitely reduce, right? And then there is a point in light intensity when there is no gaseous exchange in photosynthesis taking place. And over here, we call it light compensation point. Like we had the carbon dioxide compensation point wherein it was equal, the CO2 levels coming out and going in were equal and... That was carbon dioxide compensation point. Likewise, we have a light compensation point, which we need to know. What is this light compensation point? It can be defined like a point in light intensity when no gaseous exchange take place. Yeah? And of course, a plant will not be able to survive for long at such compensation point because there would be a net loss of glucose being produced. And when there is no glucose production over there, growth and other physiological processes are never possible. Okay? Now, one more point which we need to know is something called light saturation point. Now, what is this light saturation point? The light intensity at which a plant can achieve maximum photosynthesis is light saturation point. So, I'll just write the definition for you all. A point at which maximum photosynthesis is seen. That is what is your light saturation point, which again varies from plant to plant. Now, as I told you, we have two categories, that is shade-loving plant and the sun-loving plants, right? So, for that we need to mention over here that for a shade-loving plants, its value is 10% of full sunlight. In case of your sun loving C3 plant, it is 50 to 70% of full sunlight, and in case of sun loving C4 plant, it's 200% of full sunlight. Yeah, beyond the saturation point, the rate of photosynthesis declines. And this phenomena is called solarization. Okay? So, that's the new term I'm introducing over here. Solarization. What is solarization, guys? Decrease in rate of photosynthesis. Beyond saturation point. Now, why does such solarization happen? The solarization occurs because of two phenomena. There is something called, first one, that's called photo inhibition. And the second one, that is photo oxidation. Now, what is this photo inhibition? What happens is, there is a reduction in hydration. Water content reduces and the stomata closes. Matlab, photosynthesis will now be inhibited as stomata is closed and there can't be any kind of gaseous exchange. So, for photo inhibition, I'm mentioning closure of stomata. And when I talk about photooxidation, what is photooxidation? It is oxidation of the photosynthetic pigments. Yeah, it could be even oxidation of certain intermediates, certain kind of enzymes. So if your pigments are oxidized, of course they can't photosynthesize, and hence the rate of photosynthesis will reduce. So over here, damage to photosynthetic pigments. Now, children, let's talk about the next factor under light only. That could be light quality. Now, guys, our plants capture light at your visible spectrum. That's ranging from 400 to 700 nanometers. It is 400 to 700 nanometers, which is trapped. This range specifically is termed to be PAR. Guys, PAR stands for photosynthetically active radiation. And you know, it has this particular PAR region has the spectrum. The spectral components are said to be Wibgeur. You know what is Wibgeur, right? And the most effective amongst them, this particular Wibgeur, is your blue region and red. And the least effective is green. Okay? Now, children, you know that all living plants have all the physiological activities which are regulated by catalyst called enzymes. And all the enzymes existing are controlled by temperature. Over here also, we know that our dark reaction, the reaction wherein carbon assimilation takes place, is controlled by enzyme. Right? So, dark reaction requires enzyme, which is in turn controlled by temperature. So of course, whenever there is a kind of varying temperature, your enzymes become sensitive and the rate of photosynthesis would be affected. But this is happening in dark reaction. Light reaction is relatively less sensitive to it. Okay? Again, as we have different kinds of plants like your C4 variety and your C3 variety, the temperature, the plants also respond to the varying temperature in a different way. Like your C4 plants respond to higher temperature, like around 30 to 40 degrees Celsius, they are still effectively converting. On the other hand, your C3 will show at a higher temperature, that is 20 to 25 degrees Celsius. Matlab the optimum rate of photosynthesis is what they are showing. Your C4 is showing at 30 to 40 degrees Celsius and C3 is showing at 20 to 25 degrees Celsius. Okay? Also, the optimum temperature depends on the habitat. Now, the tropical plants have a higher temperature optimum than the plants which are adapted to temperate region. So, we have tropical region, the one which is going to show more productivity when it comes to photosynthesis. Okay? The next factor that comes up is water. Now, children, we know that water is one of the reactants involved in light reaction. The effect of water as a factor is more through its effect on the plant. So it indirectly affects photosynthesis. It is more on the plant. Like if you have something called a water stress, like less amount of water is there. There's something called water stress. Now plant is going to react in different ways. There could be something called closure of stomata. Or it could be wilting of leaves. So if there is less amount of water present, the plant may either close stoma or it will bring about wilting of leaves. Now what happens if stoma is closed? If the stoma is closed, then the levels of CO2 drops. Matlab, the rate of photosynthesis is also going to drop. On the other hand, if wilting of leaves is seen, so what happens is the surface area reduces and hence the photosynthesis also reduces. So eventually water stress is going to lead to less amount of photosynthesis, but it could be either via closure of stoma, immediate activity would be closing stomata or wilting of leaves. Okay. Now let's talk about the last factor, that is certain inhibitors involved, the photosynthetic inhibitors. Yeah, now such inhibitors can be used as your weedicides or herbicides. For example, we have something called DCMU. This DCMU stands for dichlorophenyl dimethyl urea. Yeah. Also, we have something called CMU, which is called monouron. We also have something called PAN, which is peroxyacetyl nitrate. So now these three, that's your DCMU, CMU and PAN, they are known to inhibit photosynthesis by blocking PS2. So blocks PS2. You know specifically where? They are the ones which are going to stop the electron flow between your P680 and plastoquinone. Other than them, you also have some more, like we have diquat, we have paraquat, these are the ones which are going to inhibit the cyclic photophosphorylation. So blocks cyclic, and specifically they are going to block between your P700 and FD. Somewhere in between them is going to block the electron flow. Okay, so that was all with the inhibitors, and with this I have covered your factors affecting rate of photosynthesis. and we have covered the chapter Photosynthesis Children. I hope you have very clearly understood the chapter. Thank you so much for listening to me.